Do this. This came in 2006.
So is it D?
D for donkey?
Yes, sir.
Yes, D is correct. All of you getting D?
Yes, sir.
A thin circular ring of mass M, radius R, is rotating about its axis with constant angular velocity omega. Two objects are attached gently on the opposite ends of the diameter of the ring. The ring now rotates with angular velocity omega dash equals to what? Now, you know, even if you are a little bit confused about the concept, you don't have any other option other than using conservation of angular momentum. Okay, so that should just pop up in your head, that conservation of angular momentum I can use here about the center of mass. So your system is these two objects and the ring. So if you consider these two objects and the ring as a system, then the forces between them becomes internal force. So you can't say that that is external torque. Okay, so you can conserve angular momentum. When you do I1 omega 1 is equal to I2 omega 2, I1 is mr square, but I2 is not mr square. I2 is mr square plus capital mr square plus another capital mr square, because moment of inertia when you place two objects changes. Suppose you know, you have one object here, another object there. Okay, so moment of inertia of these two objects is mr square and capital mr square, both capital mr square. So two capital mr square is a moment of inertia of these two objects itself plus moment of inertia of the ring, which is mr square. So this is new moment of inertia into new angular momentum, sorry, new angular velocity, let's say omega 1. This is equal to initial angular momentum, this into omega. So you get omega 1 from this particular equation. Okay, so option D will come out to be correct here. Any doubt on this? Anyone, please type in or say. All right, anyone got the answer?
So I'm getting B.
B for Bombay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, many are getting option D to be correct. That must be correct only. 20. Yes, B is correct. B for Bombay. All right. So here, I'll just give hint with respect to this question. Okay. So let's say you have a bigger ring like this. This is radius 2R. And another ring, this is disc, correct? This is disc of radius 2R, then a disc of radius R is removed so that their circumferences touches. So this disc is removed. Okay. Now the center of mass of the new disc is alpha by R from the center of the bigger disc. The value of alpha is what? So basically, you know, the question is about finding center of mass of this remaining structure. So this remaining structure is symmetrical about this horizontal line, yes or no? So center of mass should lie horizontally somewhere, okay? So let's say that center of mass coordinate is x here, all right? So we can also say that if I add the smaller disk on this particular structure, then I will get the bigger disk, okay? If I add this smaller disk on this one, I will get a bigger disk of radius 2R. Okay, so without changing the coordinate axis, which remains same, I can locate the center of mass coordinate for this, which is what, R by 2 comma 0. Okay, the center of mass will be here somewhere. And its center of mass is 0, 0, and this one is unknown. Now, you can say that this bigger disk is made up of this and this smaller disk. So the center of mass coordinate for this bigger one should be equal to, let's say mass of that is m1 into x plus mass of that is, let's say, m2. Then m2 into r by 2 divided by m1 plus m2. This is center of mass location of this bigger one, which is what? Zero. Okay. So when you equate that to zero, you'll get the value of x, which is the center of mass of this structure. Okay. Now you get the you get a relation between m1 and m2. You need not know the value of m1 and m2, because you know, you can cancel out the constants from numerator, denominator, or anyway it is equated to zero. So the mass is proportional to the surface area, because the mass is uniformly distributed over the area. So just write constant times area of the structure as mass, and that's how you get the value of x, and then you can answer this question. Okay. If there is any doubt on this, please message or say it. I'll move to next one.
So won't it be m2 into r?
M2 into
r.
See, the radius of, oh yeah, sorry, this is r. Distance of this point is r. The center is r for the smaller one. So you're correct. This is r only. Okay. I've taken diameter as r. So this point x coordinate is r only. So m2 into r. Okay. Good. Any other doubt? I'll move to next one. This one. Try to solve this. This is, I think, a simple one. Don't get, bogged down by just looking at number of marks and subjective question. It can be solved easily. This is the last question for the day. You can easily, you can take your time, get it correct, okay? And you have 5 to 10 minutes to solve this question.
So is the answer almost 3?
No. There are two uniform thin rods, each of masses 0.01, 0.02, rigidly joined, the combination pivoted at lighter end. It can rotate about point P. A small object moving hits the lower end, sticks to it. Fine. So now when the small object hits the rod, okay, can you conserve the linear momentum?
So it is 0.6.
No, it is not. Can you conserve linear momentum when the small mass hits the rod? Yes or no? Can I conserve linear momentum?
Yes, sir.
Others? Those who are on
YouTube, sir.
Can I conserve linear momentum just before and after? You cannot conserve linear momentum just before and after collision, because it is hinged at point P. Okay, so from the point P, there will be external force getting generated. Okay, because of which you cannot conserve linear momentum. Okay, and that external force at point P could be impulsive also. Large amount of force could be generated at point P. Fine, so you cannot conserve linear momentum. Okay, then in this collision, what you should conserve just before and after? See, during collision, only in elastic collision, there is conservation of energy that happens. And here it is not elastic collision, it sticks to it. So you cannot conserve energy just before and after. So what you are left with? Conservation of angular momentum, nothing else. There has to be some equation that links what is happening before with what will happen later on. Okay, so you are going to conserve angular momentum. You can see that even though there is a force from point P, but because of that force, the torque with respect to point P or any axis passing through point P will be zero. Yes or no? Because the perpendicular distance of that force, which is acting at point P, from the point P itself is zero. So the torque due to that hinge force will be equal to zero with respect to the axis passing through P. All of you agree?
Yes, sir.
So since,
yes, sir.
Since that is the axis where the net external torque is zero, even though there is net external force, but net torque about axis passing through P is zero, so you can conserve angular momentum about that axis. You cannot conserve angular momentum about any other axis, because there is a prerequisite to conserve angular momentum. You can only conserve it about an axis about which net external torque is zero, and that axis is an axis passing through P. Okay. Now, what is the initial angular momentum of the part of the system total? Is there any angular momentum of the rod initially?
No.
No. So angular momentum of the particle plus angular momentum of rod initially should be equal to angular momentum of particle plus angular momentum of rod finally. So angular momentum of rod is zero, but what is the angular momentum of particle? Perpendicular distance into its momentum, right? So let's say velocity is V. So mass times velocity into its perpendicular distance, which is what? This much. Yes or no? This distance is how much? Let's say this distance is 2L. Each has length L, which is 0.6 meter. So MV into 2L. Is there any doubt on this?
No, sir.
This is an initial angular momentum. This should be equal to final angular momentum. Now, see, the thing is, when the particle hits the rod, it becomes the part of the rod itself. Okay. So I can say that these two together can be treated as a single mass, a single rigid body, that is equal to moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega. Okay. And what is the moment of inertia about the fixed axis? If you look at this, the thinner rod has mass, let us say M1. That is about P, its moment of inertia is M1 L square by 3. Okay. Plus, let's take the thicker rod. Thicker rod, I need to use parallel axis theorem. I will translate this center of mass axis from here. Okay. This is going into the board. Okay. From here till here. The moment of inertia about this axis, which is this one, which is center of mass axis, we know that it is equal to, let's say, M2 L square by 12. Okay. Plus, this is center of mass axis, plus M2 into L plus L by 2 whole square. This into omega. Okay. Sorry, this is the moment of inertia I'm finding. Fine. This is the moment of inertia of these two rods. Plus, there's a particle also whose mass is M, let us say. So M into 2L square. So this is the total moment of inertia after the collision about that axis. Fine. So from here, you'll get the value of omega. Fine. All of you understanding what I'm doing here?
Yes, sir.
Those who are on YouTube, please type in yes or no. Are you getting it? Is there any doubt? Okay. Okay. All right. So I have just got the angular velocity immediately after the collision. Okay. Now what should I do? I have the situation that it is just able to become horizontal. This entire system, there is this thin rod, and then there is a thick rod. This rod along with the mass, it becomes horizontal. Fine. Initially, it was like this. Fine. So what should I do between this point and that point? I have its angular velocity. What should I do?
Work energy theorem.
Work energy theorem. So simply I'll use W is equal to, see, this question is subjective question. Okay. So this kind of question may not be asked in objective question as objective question, because this will consume a lot of time to solve. But then a small part of this question can be asked. They can just ask you what is the angular velocity after the collision, something like that. So, but then you'll get to learn many concepts from this single question. That is why we're doing it. K1 plus U1. Okay. So W is zero and K2 is also zero. It just able to become horizontal. Okay, guys, see, many a times our focus is to get the answer and, you know, don't focus on the answer. And in that process, at times I see that, you tend to become so focused about telling the right answer that you resort to other means also. So those who are not getting the answers correct, don't get intimidated by, first of all, that many people are able to answer the questions. You are not able to. It is perfectly fine. Okay. So just keep your morale high and keep working hard. Your hard work will not go waste. That you can take in writing from me. Okay. So, and also those guys, don't try to, focus only on the answer. Look at the understanding of it, how we are analyzing the particular scenario and all that, because this exact same question will not come, but the learning will remain with you. So the final potential energy, you can see that one way of finding potential energy is to find out the location of center of mass of this entire rod plus mass system and find out how much height it has gone up to. Okay, that is one way of writing potential energy. The other way is just you can split this entire thing into three parts. Okay, for example, potential energy of the thin rod, let's say TR, then potential energy of the thick rod, so that is also TR. So you can say THR. It's a thick rod. Okay, the second potential energy, or we can just write T1 and U1 and U2, U dash and U double dash. And this is potential energy for the mass. Okay. How much is U dash? U dash is mass of this thin rod, which is M1, into G. And how much is center of mass has gone up by this distance, which is what? L by 2. So M1 G L by 2. U double dash will be equal to M2 G. You can see its center of mass was here, which is what distance? This from here to here, L plus L by 2. Okay. So this is 3L by 2. So mg into 3L by 2. Okay. And potential energy for that mass which was moving is mg into 2L, because it has gone from here up till here. So this is how much it has moved up. Fine. So you can split the potential energy and write no need of finding center of mass. Okay. The value of K1 is what? Half I about the fixed axis into omega square. Okay. And U1 is the initial potential energy. So you can say that this horizontal line, which passes from the below, this horizontal line represents the zero potential energy line. Okay. So with respect to this line, you can write down all the potential energies. You can write down potential energy for this. See, the potential energy initially for this rod is not zero, guys. Okay. So, I think I missed a point here. So, see, the thing is, I have assumed this as zero potential energy line. Okay, so with respect to this, final potential energy for this position is M1G2L, M2G2L, and MG2L, because all of them are at a height of 2L from the zero potential energy line. Okay, initially their potential energy will be M1 into G into this height, okay, which is 3L by 2, okay, plus M2 into G into L by 2, because this center of mass is this much height, and this small m is at zero potential energy, so that is not coming in picture. So when you solve this equation, then you'll get the answer. Getting it? So this one was little involved question. I urge you to again revisit this question. Try to solve it yourself. You will learn many small concepts from this single question itself. Okay, so that's it for today. I hope you have learned many things today, and don't forget to like the session, okay, before leaving. And let me know if there is something bothering you, or you want me to revise any other concept. Why don't you suggest a concept immediately after this class? You can WhatsApp me what next you want me to revise, or some concern you have with respect to any topic here and there. Okay, so that's it for today, and we'll see you next time.
Bye bye. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.